Great. So we're waiting for you. So if you're ready, should we
start? Let's start. So thank you very much for coming for the defense of Javier Mejía. So I will present all the professors involved in the evaluation. So Professor Matthew Jackson is a professor of economics at Stanford University and external faculty member of the Santa Fe Institute and senior fellow of CIPAR. Matthew Jackson's research interests include game theory, microeconomic theory, and the study of social and economic networks, on which he has published many articles and the book Social and Economic Networks. Jackson is a member of the National Academy of Sciences, a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, a fellow of the Econometric Society, a Game Theory and Society Fellow, and an Economic Theory Fellow. And his other honors include the Pandemic Award, the Guggenheim Fellowship, and the Social Choice and Welfare Prize, DBO Arrow Prize for Senior Economist and Teaching Award. He has served as a co-editor of Game and Economic Behavior, the Hobby of Economic Design, and Econometric. Now, Thomas Rodriguez. Thomas is associate professor at the Department of Economics at Universidad de Los Andes. He holds a BSc in Mathematics and Economics from the London School of Economics and from Oxford University. His research interests lie with game theory, and his focus to date has been on models of interaction in networks and application. His research has benefited significantly from the insights of other social sciences, especially sociology and psychology. Thomas has been referred for recognized academic journals, such as Game and Economic Behavior, Econometrica, and Quarterly Journal of Economics. His articles have been published in Game and Economic Behavior, Entropy, and American Economic Review. Fabio Sanchez. He's professor at the University of Los Angeles. He was previously head of the macroeconomic analysis unit of the National Planning Department during the crisis. We don't know if there is a causal relation. Researcher at Fedesario and director and researcher at CEDE. His research focuses on economics of education, economic history, development economics, labor economics, and economic policy. His publication includes books such as Historical Statistics of Colombia, The Accounts of Violence, and Essays on Monetary and Banking History in Colombia, as well as numerous articles published in national and international academic journals. And Andres Alvarez, they don't give me any view of you, he's a professor in Los Andes and works in history and Javier's advisor and works in history and
development. That's good. It's not to say I'm behind Javier's advisor, he's my mate.
Javier, you have about 30 minutes to present your thesis, and next you will have some questions from Matthew Jackson, Thomas Fabio.
Yes. Well, thank you. Thank you for being here. I don't have much time. I'm going to present three papers. I'm going to start pretty fast. Let me start by reminding you how economics was born as a science that tried to explain the harmony of society through market interactions, right? So if you think a bit about it, the most important theoretical developments in economics are pretty much about that. So if you think about the invisible hand of Adam Smith, the general equilibrium theory, even all that stuff in macro that no one really cares about, all that is about people interacting in markets and arriving, reaching eventually equilibriums and behaving properly and everyone is happy, right? However, once again, if you think a bit about your life, probably you're aware that most of your interaction develops in non-market environments, right? So we have parents, we have partners, we have colleagues, friends, and all our interactions with them are developing in non-market environments, right? And recently, and I mean by that in the last two decades or so, economics has paid attention to that, mostly applied microeconomics. And now we know that non-market interactions or social interactions, as we call them, are fundamental if we want to understand things like school performance, there's a small lack here, criminal behavior, employment conditions, electoral outcomes, even life expectancy. Nevertheless, economic history is a bit behind this trend, and we don't know pretty much anything about how social interactions affected economic performance in the very long term. And that's precisely what I tried to do in this dissertation. So I tried to open a discussion on two particular issues. One, on how did non-market interactions shape the economy in the long term, and how did economic activity shape non-market interactions in the long term, right? So I'm going to take you today through a journey over history, trying to show you that if we miss social interaction, we are going to have problems understanding how our system has become what it is today. And let's go really back in time. Let's go to the Paleolithic. It doesn't look quite well here, the image, but there it looks super pretty. And we're going to think about tribal societies, right? So imagine societies before the emergence of states and markets. They were very heterogeneous in many ways, so it's hard to pin down what main attribute they had. But probably there's just one that characterizes all of them, and it is their relational pattern, which is basically that they were deeply connected at local level and very isolated from one another. So think about small bands, tribes, isolated the one to the other. And why is that interesting? Well, the first thing is that it has been the most common social configuration in history. So we as humans, as Homo sapiens, most of the time have ended up interacting in these kind of societies. And I mean by this for several thousands of years, right? So it seems important to understand them better. And there's also a sort of intellectual challenge related to their comprehension, because it's hard to understand how they were stable if they didn't have states, they didn't have markets. Think that the most important explanations in social science about social order are based on that, right? Economics is about how the society is stable through markets, and political science and law is about how a state keeps everything in order, right? So how is it possible that these societies were stable if they didn't have neither of them? And indeed, there are several explanations, but what I try to do in this paper is to argue that those explanations don't explain properly the stability of these societies, and I'm offering probably one that fits better the data. So there are basically two sort of explanations. The first one is an institutional explanation, let's say, which basically claims that hunter-gathering and like early agriculture was a really uncertain and risky activity, right? So I've never hunted a mammoth, but I can imagine that it was pretty hard, right? So of I don't know how many millions of times you tried to hunt a mammoth, well, most of the time you didn't get it, right? So the thing to be really connected at local level probably was the result of the emergence of an institution in order to share the risk of that thing. So well, probably some people didn't get the mammoth, but some other were like gathering berries and they could share, and when there were no berries because of the weather, well, eventually someone would get a mammoth. The problem with that explanation is that many of these societies didn't have this sort of institutions, right? So there's this idea that these were egalitarian societies, but we've recently find out that that was not the case, that many, many of these societies were hierarchical societies that didn't have this sort of sharing institutions, right? So that doesn't work really well as an explanation. There's another explanation, which is rather a sort of cultural explanation, in which most of the authors in this tradition think that, well, probably is that Homo sapiens have a basic unit of social interaction, which is family, the idea of a nuclear family, right? Like the procurador sort of family, like mom, dad, and children, right? And basically they got together and they formed larger sort of societies. And that's pretty much it. And the point is that several of these societies didn't have nuclear families at all. So there are several examples in history with a lot of evidence from archaeological data that certain societies, for instance, had complete polygamy, right? So all of the members in the society had sex, and all of the kids in the tribe were didn't have like a pair of parents, but they were the children of the whole society, right? So neither of these explanations kind of works pretty well if you think about the data. So what I tried to do is I tried to say, like, well, okay, what about if we use the tools that we have to understand network structures and try to explain this particular pattern, right? Very deeply connected networks at local level and fairly isolated at aggregate level. And that's precisely what I tried to do in this paper. And I tried basically to ask myself, what explains the stability of tribal societies? And how do I do that? Well, I use the a fairly standard network formation model. This is an applied micro theory paper. So for those of you who are not aware of this literature, it's basically a sort of game theory approach to how people create connections among them. So imagine rational individuals that try to form links between each other. The main challenge there is that the profits of me connecting with, let's say, Tomas, does not depend only on my behavior and his behavior and attributes, but it depends also on whom he is connected with and whom those connections are connected with, and whom those connections and those connections and those connections are connected with. So that's a incredible difficult problem in the sense that there's this huge sort of dimensional interdependency, right? And that's basically one of the main contributions to this field by Matt and others. And like the genius there is to make tractable that kind of problem. So I basically take that theoretical tool and I use it to this particular context. And I, as I told you, I use a sort of canonical model in this field, but I do two sort of modifications. So on the one hand, I assume that the support of a particular tie reduces the interaction cost. And by that, I mean that, let's say that I want to be connected with Tomas, but I don't know anyone that is connected with him. But if I am connected with Andres and Andres knows Tomas, for me it's going to be cheaper to interact with Tomas. And now let's say that I also know Fabio and Fabio knows as well Tomas. Then it's going to be even cheaper to interact with Tomas. And it's the basic idea, probably some of you have experienced this once in your life, which is that you meet someone that is friend of all your friends, and somehow you became immediately friend of him. It's like, we've been buddies for all our lives, right? And that's the basic idea, and that's the main like assumption that I modify in the model, okay? And I put that sort of theoretical framework in a productive system, a pre-modern productive system in which there are two types of technology. We have hunter-gatherers, and we have farmers, people that produce and have and has an agricultural sector, okay? And once you do these tiny modifications to the canonical network formation model, you get a sort of clear answer to this question, and it is that basically this force of the decreasing marginal cost of supported social interactions make particularly stable this sort of tribal configurations, right? And you can tell why, right? If it is cheaper to interact with people to whom you have sort of connections indirectly, well, it is clear the force that generates these sort of clusters at local level, okay? So the main contribution of this paper is that basically it offers an explanation of tribal society that is consistent with this heterogeneity in institutional and cultural at institutional and cultural levels. And there's also a sort of methodological contribution, which is to introduce network formation theory in tribal societies. Believe it or not, in evolutionary anthropology, there's a lot of people working on doing that. So the model has several results in terms of describing under which circumstances you will see societies more complex than others. That's an important question for evolutionary anthropology. I'm not going to go into the details of them in the sake of time, but I just want to tell you that first, they're not at all trivial, they're not like super intuitive, but they are consistent with the most recent results in archaeology, and that's really cool, I guess. And there's another set of results related to societal collapse. So the things that in history, several times, societies have disappeared from the face of Earth. And think about the Mayas and these sort of things that you see in National Geographic. And recently, we've been concerned about this, right? Facing global warming and nuclear threats and stuff. And the model has some claims about it. I'm just going to say that it basically concludes that a society that has develop or discover agriculture could survive in any kind of ecosystem. However, if interaction costs are super high, that could have led to the collapse of that society. And I think that that's really interesting if we think at our current sort of problems in which we have racism increasing, we have restrictions to migration, we have religious extremism, which are basically constraints to the interaction between people, right? Are basically, they represent higher cost of social interaction. That's pretty much everything about the first bit. And let's move a bit further in time. And let's move to the arrival of modern economic growth. So just imagine that societies keep evolving in the sense that they became more complex. But for centuries and centuries, they had pretty much the same living conditions. And I'm going to show you this in this picture. This is the same spot in New York City. This is Fifth Avenue at Madison Square Garden, at Madison Square Park. And this is a representation in 1852. And this is some decades later, late 1920s. And you can see how in a generation, the society was transformed dramatically. That's basically the arrival of modern economic growth. So modern economic growth is the sustained growth in income per capita joined with structural change, basically with the emergence of an industrial sector. Okay? Why it is important to understand? Well, it was one of the most dramatic changes in social history, and if you don't trust like this visual kind of evidence, well, let's just consider that something like 97% of the population that has existed on Earth, it came after the industrialization, so therefore they are the product of modern economic growth. And we can tell the same sort of thing about the wealth created by the society. And it's not just about these aggregate measures, it's also about our living conditions. So since the arrival of modern economic growth, things like life expectancy have more than doubled, right? And much more than that has happened with literacy rates. Even things that change really slowly related with evolutionary threats happen after modern economic growth. We've grown something like 10 centimeters since the arrival of modern economic growth. So it seems pretty important. Now, why should we expect any relation between modern economic growth and social interactions? Well, there's a literature in growth and population diversity that has some empirical regularities in this regard. So there's an agenda on political economy that basically thinks about how the ethnic diversity in a country is related to the current economic performance of these places. And they find a negative correlation. Basically, countries more diverse are, in their view, less developed nowadays. And their explanation is a sort of political economy explanation in which they think like, well, we have all these different people in this country, they have problems solving collective problems, right? So they have problems creating a state, providing public goods, and that has an impact on economic performance. But there's another agenda that with similar data finds different relation, which is kind of funny, but that happens a lot in empirical economics, right? And it is the literature mostly related with innovation, in which they argue that there's a positive correlation between the diversity in a country and their economic performance in the long term. And their explanation is something about, like, well, if you have different people, you can have new ideas. If you have identical and really homogeneous societies, well, a lot of people identical talking about the same sort of things do not come with new ideas, and that's not the fertile kind of soil for innovation. So basically what I tried to do in this paper is to take this sort of intuition and put it in a pretty mainstream road model and try to see what happens. So the question of this paper is to understand how do social interactions and long-term economic growth co-evolve. Now, you can tell there that there's not a casual like directionality in the question, right? And how do I do it? As I told you, I take a fairly standard growth model, think about a sort of, you know, classical growth model, and I make two sort of modifications in it. First, I consider that households interact in non-market environments, and I consider that knowledge is transmitted through those interactions, right? So it's not something that is sold in a educational market, but it's something that is transmitted through interactions. And I'm going to show you some supportive evidence that the model seems to be well fitted to the data, okay? And the answer that I get using this method is that ancestral barriers to social interactions, basically how costly it was in the past to interact between different kind of people, think about people from different races, different religions, affected the timing of the arrival of modern economic growth. Basically, societies where it was more expensive to interact between different people would have taken longer to industrialize and are supposed to be poorer today. That's what the model predicts in with regard to this direction between social interactions than economic growth. With regard to the opposite direction, the model basically predicts a really stable sort of path in social interactions and a reduction in social distance once the society industrializes, one economic growth arrives. What's the logic of it? What's like the rationale of the model? Well, imagine that you are in this traditional society, right? There's no educational markets. There's no place where you can get all the knowledge that you need to create the new sector that is going to push growth in a sustained way, which is, would be basically industry. But that knowledge is distributed in the society, right? Different kind of people have different kind of knowledge. Therefore, societies where it is cheaper to put in touch different people, well, are more likely to put together those resources and to industrialize. Once the society industrializes and it becomes valuable, this kind of knowledge, then it becomes cheaper to interact between these different kind of people, and that's what reduces the distance at social level, right? It becomes cheaper to interact between different people, the society becomes more connected. That's basically the sort of the logic of the model. And what's the contribution of the paper then? It's basically to offer a sort of unified explanation of these really important empirical regularities that were kind of isolated. So let me show you, and I'm going to need the mouse, I guess, here. I'm no longer in camera, but I'm here. And these are the results. So there are several results. I think that all of them are super cool, but there are two in particular that I think are great, and those are the ones that I'm going to talk about today. So the first one is that the fewer the restrictions to social interactions in ancestral times, and think that we already have discussed what drives the social structure in these ancestral times, the sooner the industrial takeoff. And here there's some evidence on this regard. So these are countries, and this is the linguistic distance of those countries before the industrialization. So basically it is how different were the languages spoken by individuals in one country before they industrialized. They could be super similar if everyone spoke, let's say, Spanish, or they could be very different if they spoke Spanish and Chinese. So, and basically what you can tell here, this is the timing of the industrial takeoff, basically the moment when the society is industrialized, And you can see this positive correlation. Basically, the more distant were the languages they used to spoke, the longer they had to industrialize. Which is basically what my model predicts.
Would you mind?
Yeah.
Thank you.
So just that there are several other results I think that are consistent. No, no, don't go to that one. Because it's not that cool, right? Let's go to the super result of the paper, which gives basically insights on how social interaction has evolved in time, which is something that hasn't been done before in growth. And basically the model predicts that before the industrialization, the social interaction should have been really stable. And once it industrializes, the connectivity of the society should have increased, therefore the distance in society should have reduced. And this is how this thing looks. This is a graph from a recent paper published in Science like 2 months ago, which uses data of ancestry.com, which includes basically captures genealogical trees of people all over the world. So they have something like 9 million of observations. And they basically have here the genetic distance between spouses per year, right? And what you can tell is that it was fairly high. They were really, spouses were really similar genetically, and this fits basically with the idea of marrying your cousin. That was pretty frequent too long ago. And once the society industrializes, you can tell how the genetic distance increases. I have some additional data from my work in Antioch, and I'm going to move to that paper in 1 second, in which I show you that once the society industrializes, the average path length and the diameter of the network, so I'm going to reconstruct the network of this elite in Antioquia, it's going to reduce. Basically, the society is going to become more cohesive. Okay? And that's pretty much what that paper is about. Sorry about it. And I don't need to be anymore here. And I have just 5 minutes for the most important paper. 0 or 5? which is indeed my job market paper. And here what I try to do is, okay, like in the macro perspective, everything seems quite easy. The new sector emerges and that's great. Well, everyone is richer, better connected. But what happens when you zoom in things in this context? And the particular question is, what drives individuals to get involved in this new sector? They were raised in this traditional society. How they do decide to become industrial entrepreneurs, right? And that's, by the way, Colombia in the beginnings of the 19th century. So in this paper, I basically try to answer the question about the relationship between entrepreneurship and social interactions. And I have a very particular answer for that question, which is that there's a particular feature of the position of an individual in his network that relates positively and significantly with becoming an entrepreneur, which is to be capable of connecting efficiently and cheaply different kind of individuals, right? What's the rationale of that result? Well, if you are in a developing context, markets don't work properly. And entrepreneurship is this super complex activity in which you need a bunch of different kind of resources and you cannot get them from markets because markets don't work properly. Then you need to use your social network. Now there's five, great. And basically the one who has the best network in this case is the one who is capable to put together different kind of people that provides him with the different kind of resources that he needs at the same time to become an entrepreneur. Okay, that's the general story of the paper. How I do that? Well, I take a particular historical episode. This is Antioquia in the late 19th and early 20th century. What I do is I reconstruct the social network of the elite of this region, which were the social class that involved in industrial entrepreneurship. I record all the information available on industrial entrepreneurial activity, and I basically see how the position of an individual in the network relates with his activity as an entrepreneur. It's a fairly simple approach. And the main contribution of this paper is that it is the first sort of exercises that gives you some insight on how the structure of the global network, and I mean by this that I'm going to know who married with who, got married with who were friends between each other, who was the son of the guy, so the sort of real network that these people were facing. And I want to tell you that this is a much more complex historical exercise that the frontier in the field has ever been. So the first thing is that I'm going to understand entrepreneurship as any process of engaging in a new and risky productive activity. So this is basically transformational entrepreneurship. And I'm going to tell you that the networks are going to work as a mechanism for gathering different kind of resources. So these people will need to, in the empirical context, will need to import really expensive machines from Europe, for instance. And they couldn't just call FedEx to do it. So they had to be connected with someone capable of bringing that to Antioch, and they had to bring technicians to repair those machines. And they had to train the workers. So all those things, they would do it through their network. The empirical exercise, as I told you, is in Antioquia. This is in the northern part of South America. And it is a great context because it highlights the regular conditions of developing context, right? So it has